Hi, welcome to chapter 10, and this is our very last chapter.
Aww, can't believe it. It's a bummer.
I'm sure they're all like, yay, thank goodness. Anyways, all right, so we're going to talk about, I actually really do like this chapter because I think it's very practical. I think it's a lot of lessons that we can learn just like in our daily lives and ways that we can apply what we can do to live out the theology of the body. So the first point that they brought up is that authentic love takes work. And I think we know that. I mean, after all of this discussion of theology of the body and just like the fact that love should be the love of God, right? Like for us sinners, you know, that's hard. And so it takes work, it takes effort, but it's something that's possible because God wouldn't call us to something that wasn't possible without his grace, right? So he gives us the grace and the ability, but remember that grace builds on nature. And so we have to do what we can to kind of like respond to that grace. So these are just a couple of tips and some things that, that we've learned.
Yeah. So talking about grace building on nature, the first place that love is supposed to be modeled to us is our family. Mm-hmm. And hopefully, ideally, true self-sacrificial, love, willing the good of the other was modeled to you and your family. And if it was, then, you know, that's a space and a place that you can look to learn from and then expand to the rest of the world. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, though, it's not always the case where self-sacrificial love is modeled. A lot of times use is modeled in the family. So what I sort of encourage you to do is to take a moment to examine your family relationships and imagine maybe yourself as parents or maybe... as grandparents, and ask yourself, what sort of dynamics do you want to keep, and what sort of dynamics do you hope maybe don't follow you, as well? And that's that kind of a good litmus test, because again, they mentioned trust your conscience. Jason and Chrislina both mentioned trust your conscience. Well, like you know, you do know what you want as a father or mother, and those are kind of. That's an easy way to know what in your family is teaching you love, and what in your family. Maybe as you develop and mature, you need to step away from or model differently to the members of your family.
Yeah, I know just reflecting on my own life and my own family experiences that there was a lot of ways in which true, authentic love was modeled by my parents and just like in the various dynamics between like me and my brother and my parents and me and my parents to each other. But ultimately, I know there was a lot of brokenness as well. And there's a lot of things that I sort of learned from them that I see myself doing in my life naturally that aren't good, right? And that aren't the fullness of love. And so I can kind of look to those moments in my relationship with them to see like the good things that they've taught me, but I can also see the ways in which I want to go in a different direction in my life, right? So, so it's just good to examine that. And it's okay to recognize that like, every family is messy. No family is perfect. There's a lot of really good families out there. There's a lot of really broken families out there. But, like, all of us are, like Madi said, kind of like a soap opera, right? Like, all of us kind of have our drama and our problems, and whether they're more out in the open or more behind the scenes. But that's okay. And, like, what's really beautiful is that Jesus himself did not run away from that mess, right? Like, he himself entered into, like, he was the all-perfect eternal God, and yet he became man and entered into a very messy family. I mean, yeah, Mary was perfect, but, like, nobody else was, right? And, like, his whole line, like, all of his ancestors, like, there were some really good people, but there were some really bad people in Jesus's ancestry, right? And yet he's, like, coming into the family, and he's not afraid to kind of, like, enter into that mess. So that means that he's not afraid to enter into our mess and the mess of our families. Mm-hmm. So we can take solace in that.
And just like Christ, just like Christ submitted himself to Joseph and to Mary for 30 years before he began his public ministry, it's hard to say that he learned anything as the divine and perfect being. Although, is it Matthew or Luke who does say that Christ grew in
I don't remember which, but he grew too, in his human nature.
So we know that he grew, and one of the ways that he grows is by learning to love in the family. And so you, as a 15 or 16-year-old, you're not at a place, you know, where you have a spousal relationship, and you're not at a place maybe where you have a truly intimate friendship either. But that's okay. Because you have a family, and it's through that family that you can learn to love. So do you want to be a good husband one day or a good wife one day? Well, practice on your family. Learn because it's mm-hmm. it's much like riding a bike, you know. No one just throws you on a bike and pushes you. They throw some training wheels
well,
on
some
you.
Might.
Well, sure. But you're supposed to have some training wheels. You're supposed to have someone guiding you. And so that's what your family is. It's kind of the opportunity to practice love
right.
so that then, you know, when you are encountering people who you're not naturally bound to, you have a little bit more virtue and a little bit more capacity to love.
Right. So, one of the quotes that John Paul said that I think was featured in our book before was that he called the family the school of love, like
mm-hmm.
literally the school of love. Like we learn to love through our experiences with our family. And again, that can be like a learning that takes place because of like modeling. So like
mm-hmm.
your family is modeling true love to you, but it could also be I'm learning love because I see my family not doing it well and I'm
right.
learning how to do the opposite, right? And so so we can learn from that, and that is that all of us have some sort of family, right? And
yeah.
that's where we can learn from.
And it can be learning via your actions. You can
mm-hmm.
do something and maybe it makes your little sister cry and you go, oh, that wasn't loving.
That wasn't a good thing.
And
yeah.
then maybe you can do something and it makes your little brother happy. And
mm-hmm.
then he goes, okay, well, maybe that's love.
Yeah.
So you learn.
You
kind of
trial and error, right?
Yeah.
Okay. One thing that Madi brought up is that you can't choose your family, but you can choose your friends. And I think it's really important to kind of take stock, like think about, like, who are the people that are in my life besides my family that I'm choosing to hang out with and around? Are they building me up or are they tearing me down? Like, are they bringing me closer to God and to the true meaning of love, or are they tearing me away from that, right? Are they teaching me to be self-sacrificial by their own example and the way that they treat myself and other people, or are they teaching me to be a user, right? Are they teaching me to just kind of take what I can get and take what I want, like whether it affects other people negatively or not, right? And you guys know that. I think if you have sort of an idea in your mind, like, if your friends are good friends or not, you know? And I think it's really important to choose godly friendships because, I mean, A, they last longer,
mm-hmm.
right? Like, they're built on something that is more than just kind of convenience of the moment. They're built on something that can lead to true support, especially in hard times in our lives, so.
Right, yeah, and I mean, every culture has their own version of the proverb, and Mari shared hers, but at the end of the day, it's every culture has it because it's universally true.
Mm-hmm.
Show me your friends and I will show you your destiny.
Mm-hmm.
So who do you... You should really strive to be friends with people who you look up to,
mm-hmm.
who you admire.
Mm-hmm.
You should always try to place yourself in the company of your betters.
Mm-hmm.
You know, not to say that in a judging way, but
right.
say that in a way of like, oh, like I like humbly admit that this person is more kind than me, and like
mm-hmm.
I want to be more kind, so I'm going to try to spend time with them.
Mm-hmm.
Show me your friends, and I'll show you your destiny.
Right.
Now, another thing on friendships in general is think back to when you were little. I think everyone, when they were little, they kind of have, there's this sort of natural desire to kind of proclaim someone your best friend.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Everybody kind of, it's like, are we best friends? Are we going to be best friends for life? There's sort of this like hierarchy that sort of naturally happens. And that's natural because it is written into our hearts. Like, we can't be emotionally vulnerable and emotionally intimate with everybody.
Right.
You know, we might have 10, 15, 20, 30, 50, 100 friends, and that's, I mean, that's awesome.
That's normal, like, yeah, like, that's fine.
That's what you're supposed to have.
Mm-hmm.
But then you need to limit, you need to encourage if you have none, you need to go out and find a way to be vulnerable with someone, but then you also need to limit to one or two really true, deeply authentic, deeply vulnerable Christ-like friendships,
right.
where you're sharing your whole heart with them because you know that they can lead you to Christ, and they're sharing
right.
their whole heart with you. There's not an imbalance there.
Mm-hmm. And you also know that you can trust them, right? So there's
mm-hmm.
certain friends that we aren't meant to be intimate with, right?
Yeah.
Because they can't handle that, or they don't want that, right? Or they're not going to be trustworthy with our heart, right? So we need to, you know, choose those close friends very wisely, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Who are the people that actually are interested in bringing me closer to God, who are interested in, like, caring about all of the intimate struggles and problems and issues that I have, but also, like, they care about my future and they care about the type of person that I become and, you know, all of that. And so, so it's okay to have a whole bunch of friends and a whole bunch of different kinds of friends, right?
Mm-hmm. Sure.
But make sure that those people that are most intimate with you are going to be supportive of the type of person that you want to become.
Yeah, and make sure that there's an equality and a balance there. You know, like
mm-hmm.
if you're completely open to someone and they're not open to you. Well, mm-hmm. Maybe that's more of a mentor type relationship.
Yeah, that could
and
be.
That's awesome, but it's not really a friendship, you know? Mm-hmm. So best case scenario, it's a mentorship. But there maybe, you know, there's something else going on. So just like make sure when you're sort of discerning who to be open and honest with, that there's a mutuality to it.
Yeah, and like different people are kind of naturally different. Like, so there's some people who are more extroverted, you know, they kind of like make friends very easily and they kind of go outside of themselves very easily. And that's me. I'm kind of like that. And so sometimes I will overshare and I'll tell too many people the intimate details of my life, right? And that can actually cause problems too, right? And so so for me, I have to consciously think like, okay, who are going to be the people that I actually reveal the intimate depths of my heart to? Like, mm-hmm. who are the couple of people, you know, like one or two or three people that I'm just going to be the super tightest with? And then everybody else, I can continue to be friends with them. I'm just not going to reveal those deep struggles to them, you know? For other people, they may have the opposite problem, right? If you're more introverted, then maybe you are okay with only having just a couple of friends, right? And that's fine. But sometimes you can run into the problem of not wanting to be truly vulnerable with anyone, mm-hmm. right? Or at least not knowing how to. And so that's something that can take some practice and like kind of deciding like, how do I open up to a person who really can care for me and like help me become the person that I'm called to be?
Yeah. And those sorts of friendships are going to help you in your vocation. Because if you're called to marriage, then if you don't have experience being vulnerable with anyone else, then there's going to be an impediment with you learning how to be vulnerable with your spouse.
With your spouse, right?
And if you're if you're called to a religious order and you're called to totally give yourself to you know, a certain whether that be the ordained priesthood or as a brother or sister, if you don't have experience like sort of taking on the sacrifice and suffering of others, then how are you going to offer up your life for an order? So those sorts of friendships are essential in preparation, and then also to thrive in your vocation. They're just as important for your holiness.
Yeah, for sure. Okay, so the second video is Jason and Kristalina just giving a whole bunch of dating tips, like just kind of rattling some things off. And me and Mr. St. Cyr both thought that all of their advice was excellent, just from our own experiences and from just different things that we've picked up from, you know, other people we've watched in our lives who have dated and things like that. And so really, really good advice. I will post that to, at least my students, I will post that to your OneNote. So I just wrote out all of the tips because they were going very fast. And so if you want to go back and look at those, there's just a few that we wanted to kind of highlight and talk about a little bit more. And so the first one that I really want to talk to is to not be afraid to be single. That was the first one I think that they said. And I think that is something that none of us want to be alone, right? Sure. Like none of us want to feel isolated. And so a lot of times we reach toward a dating relationship to kind of fulfill that desire of our heart that like all of us experience. But the problem is that God isn't always calling us to a dating relationship, right? Like sometimes he wants us to have a time of just being alone, not alone totally, right? Because we have our friendships and we're with him. And like, that's the thing is that we can find that, that communion and that intimacy through like other means than a dating relationship. But, he can do a lot for us when we are in that sort of solitude, like when we are single, when we're not trying to figure out a relationship with somebody that's intimate like that. It can be really, really good for us to discover more who we are. Because sometimes what happens is we'll jump into a dating relationship without even really knowing who we are or who God is. And then it becomes very difficult because all of a sudden we're trying to give ourselves. But how do we give ourselves when we don't even know ourselves, right? When we don't even know what we're giving. And so it's really important, especially like when we're younger, you know, and we're kind of going through these formative years of like high school and college, to kind of like really work on knowing who am I, who is God, right? What is my relationship like? What is love really like? And then kind of going out and trying that dating relationship, right? And so the single time can be really pivotal. It can be really important. And it can make our future relationships a whole lot stronger.
Right. Yeah. And that's all like great reasons for like why you should embrace being single in the positive light. But to give like a negative argument for why you should embrace being single, like, yeah, guys, being lonely sucks.
Yeah.
Like without a doubt, being lonely sucks. But you know what sucks worse?
Yeah.
Being in a pointless relationship. Where you don't even know why you're dating each other, and you come to realize that this person who you're spending time with, is just filling a hole. You don't know that person, and maybe you're just filling a hole for them. They don't know you. Being in a meaningless relationship sucks way worse.
It really does.
Like, just trust me on that. As someone who's, like, lived a little bit late, like, I've been lonely, and
yeah.
it sucks.
Yeah.
And I've also been in, like, a relationship where we're just using each other to not be lonely.
Same.
And that sucks worse.
It really does.
That is, so, like,
yeah.
like, yes, like, all the fundamental truths about how you grow closer to God and you're formed and, like, yeah, like, yes.
Mm-hmm.
But also, it just sucks worse.
Yeah.
If you're using someone just to not feel lonely.
Absolutely. So one thing that kind of feeds into that is the fact that true romances, really good and lasting romances, are built on authentic friendship. And so if we don't know how to be friends with people without just jumping into a dating relationship, then, like, we're not going to know how to have a good, you know,
mm-hmm.
dating and possibly marriage relationship later. And so to kind of build our friendships, like, be friends with people, and, like, if you are experiencing that time where you are single, like, there's not a guy in your life or not a girl in your life, and you're just, like, kind of living your life, and you've got your friends around you, like, work on those friendships and really invest in those friendships, because that's going to help you later if you do meet somebody and you start
yeah.
dating them, right? So we were talking earlier about how, like, maybe you are dating people right now, and, like, maybe that's okay. But to kind of make sure that your dating relationships, are built on that friendship, like, even in the midst of dating, and you're not kind of acting like that dating relationship is a friendship, I mean, is a marriage,
right.
Because, what happens then is if you break up, you have a lot of baggage, you have a lot of problems, like, a lot of issues that you're going to have to work through that sometimes may take a long time to work through. And they're going to affect the way that you relate to future, like, dating people or spouses.
Yeah.
So, but, like, if you have a really good dating relationship, then it's going to build this awesome foundation, whether you end up marrying that person or you end up marrying somebody else or finding a different vocation. It's going to be this solid, awesome foundation that
mm-hmm.
you have, like, happy memories that you're able to build on. So.
Yeah. When you build a relationship on a friendship, well, what's one of the big differences? Okay, discernment's a big difference, but also, like, a mutual desire is a
mm-hmm.
big difference, okay? Well, we've talked about it earlier in the program, desires come and go, attractions come and go.
Yeah.
So if you build a relationship on a friendship, then, like, when the desire goes,
mm-hmm.
there's still a firm foundation.
There's something
and
substantial still
right,
there.
And,
yeah.
And you realize that, like, you just like being in the same room as someone.
Mm-hmm.
And that's sometimes, you know, you're in a fight or, you know, you don't really want to be too physically intimate or too, like, whatever. Well, that's okay because, like, you're still friends and you
right.
can still go play sports together or play cards together or whatever it is. But if you don't have that friendship, if you kind of skip that stage
yeah.
and jump straight into, like, I want to be with you pretty much just because of our mutual desire.
Right.
Well, like, when that comes and goes, then, like, why do you want to be with them?
Right.
And so having that friendship first is a very necessary insurance policy
mm-hmm.
for when the mutual desire fades, because it does, and then it comes
mm-hmm.
back. That's kind of just the nature of relationships.
Yeah, we need, I've definitely experienced this personally, like, in a dating relationship where, you know, you kind of become friends with someone not for authentic friendship, but because you want to date them, if
mm-hmm.
that makes sense.
Yeah.
And you put kind of all of your stock in, like, how you interact with them on, like, the possibility of dating them, but you don't actually build an authentic friendship. And then, like, for me, like, I started dating this person and, like, all of a sudden it just became about, like, that desire, you know,
mm-hmm.
and it was like we didn't have this truly authentic friendship that we had built that relationship on, and it went south fast, right?
Sure.
Like, it got bad really fast, and then it was, like, over, and then we
yeah.
were like, wow, that sucked.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
And, like, I didn't really gain, you know, it was only years later when I was able to kind of look back on it and be like, I learned a lot about what not to do in a
yeah,
relationship.
Absolutely.
You know, and so there can be, like, good things that can come out of it, like, God can take good even out of evil, but, like, it's hard, you know, like,
mm-hmm.
it takes a long time to kind of work through that stuff. So
yeah, and this doesn't mean that you have
mm-hmm.
to, like, be friends for a year before you ever go on a date
yeah,
or anything.
No,
like,
it
that
doesn't have to mean that.
No, but, like, what it means is that in the beginning especially,
mm-hmm.
like, your dating should look a lot like a friendship, because
mm-hmm.
what you're doing is you're first building that friendship. So, like, no, like, take, I mean, my fiance, for example,
mm-hmm.
I asked her out, like, the third time I ever saw her.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, our first 7 or 8 dates were, like, playing sports together or hanging out, you know, and in big group settings, and we really tried hard you know, to develop a friendship. And it's been really good. So it's not like you have to be friends first, but just like in the middle of your dating relationship, it shouldn't look like marriage. In the beginning of your dating relationship, it shouldn't really even look like a dating relationship.
Like, yeah, it more like a friendship.
Look like you're building friends.
Yeah.
And that's,
so you just like go get food together, or you watch a movie, or you play cards, or you know, like you just hang out and you get to know them as a person just like you would any new friend that you met. So and then like it progresses naturally, right? And then there's more of a trust and there's more of a like foundation established that you're able to build off of, right?
So why, like, what makes a successful relationship? I get this, I've thought about this a lot. And I think we think that, like, a successful relationship is one where you get married. I think that's kind of what we're told, but I disagree with that. I think a successful relationship is a relationship where at the end of the relationship, you know yourself better and you know God better. And you can probably throw that you know the other person better as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, like, maybe the end of your relationship is when you die, you know, 60 years from now after you got married. Like, well, if you get married and you stay together and you never get divorced, but you die not knowing God better and not knowing yourself better, well, then, like, no.
It wasn't,
I'm sorry,
really
that was
marriage.
Not a successful relationship, even though you never got divorced. And at the same time, if you break up after 6 months, but at the end of that 6 months, you really do know yourself better and you really do know and love the Lord better, well, then, like, that was a massively successful relationship.
Right.
So, yes, like, the purpose of dating is to find a spouse. They said that, and I like, technically, that is right, but that's not necessarily the evaluative tool. So,
right, to say whether or not it was a good moment of my life kind of thing that I was able to glean something from. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So I think that one thing that I want to say too, I was getting some questions from some people about like, how do I know who to date? Or like, how do I know like the type of person that would make a good spouse, right? Like, how do I know that before I marry them? Well, we were talking about how love should be modeled on God's love, right? Free, total, faithful, fruitful. There's different levels of that, right?
Sure.
When you're married, that's going to look very different than when you're just dating someone or you're just friends with someone and you're trying to figure out, like, okay, is this person going to be a good spouse? Well, that sort of, like, free and total and faithful, like, that kind of stuff, how do you see that? I need to be able to look at a person and look at the way that they treat the people in their life, you know? The way that they treat the people around them that they've never met before, and they just kind of see, you know?
Sure.
The way that they treat their friends, the way that they treat their family members, and just kind of observe them, you know? And, like, what's really cool about dating is that that's kind of what you're doing. You're kind of getting to know each other, but you're also kind of observing, how does this person act, not just around me, but how does this person act around everybody else that's already in their life, you know?
Right.
So in the video, Kristalina mentioned how on some of their dates, they would like go to the homeless shelter and serve in the soup kitchen. And like, that might seem kind of weird to some of y'all, but like, if you are dating a person who is willing to sacrifice their time or whatever they would be more comfortable doing to go and actually help a person that they've never met, that says a lot about them. That says a lot about their character. And so just kind of think like, okay, how does this person spend their time? How do they treat the people around them?
Right. Yeah. And I think a sort of more global rule of discernment is what Christ said when he said, you should judge a tree by its fruits. So now let's take that rule and let's apply it particularly to how are you discerning relationships? Well, what is the fruit of this other person in your life? So I kind of break it down internally and externally. So when you're around this other person internally, do you want to be a better person? And are you proud of the person that you are? Not sort of globally, but that you are you proud of the way you act around this person? Or are you not proud of the way you act around this person? Do you, when you're around this person, do you become a better version of yourself or a worse version of yourself? So you're measuring the sort of internal fruits that they're having without saying or doing anything. Just their mere presence is having an effect on you. But then also, you measure the external fruits. So do they ask you to come to Mass? Do they ask you to go, you know, work at the homeless shelter? Do they ask you to not cheat on that test that you were planning on cheating on? Or not smoke that weed that you were planning on smoking? Like, like whatever it is, there's internal fruit that they might bear, and then there's external fruit that they might bear. So if there's sort of a mutual pulling up, well, that's like bearing good fruit, and that's a good discerning tool for whether or not you should begin or continue or develop a relationship.
Absolutely. One other thing that I wanted to point out, and then we'll move on, is that Christina, I think it was Christina that kind of mentioned this. You know, we've been talking a lot about kind of guarding our eyes against lust and things like that, like trying not to kind of be too physical or even like in our minds, like about another person, but to not use them for the pleasure that they can give us, but the but to like give to them like what they are due, right? We were talking about that. Like, what is the love that's due to this person in the relationship that we currently have, right? So like the type of love that is due to a person I just met is different than the type of love that is due to my really best friend, or that really best friend love is different than the love that's due to a spouse, right? And so what happens is that sometimes we don't realize that there's another side to this kind of giving of ourselves or even to using of another person that may not even be a like a physical imagining, but is a more of an emotional attachment that we have to a person. So I know that a lot of times now everybody can struggle with all of these things, guys absolutely. And girls, but sometimes more generally speaking, like guys will kind of struggle with the like physical lust like aspect, and girls will struggle with something that's a little more emotional. So you've got girls, you may have heard of the whole like trying on last names thing, like oh, I saw this guy and he was really cute and I really liked him, and so like now in my mind I'm gonna imagine my wedding and my bridesmaids and like what his last name sounds like with my name and like all these things, and like in my mind I'm like going through this whole thing as if like we are gonna get married when like I just met this guy, right? Or like we're not even dating, right? It's just this person that I know, and like that seems really harmless on the surface, and sometimes it is, like if it's kind of a momentary thing, but if we're dwelling on these thoughts, it's almost as if I'm kind of acting possessive of this person that I don't even really have that intimate relationship with, and that can cause a lot of problems too, and that can really hurt, because if that person then like doesn't want to date you or doesn't ask you on a date, or like maybe you do date but then you break up, like if you've been spending all of your internal like energy, like in your mind, thinking about things that are not yet, then that's going to hurt a lot. And I can speak from experience. Like when I kind of learned about this whole idea of emotional prudence, like being prudent with how I'm spending my emotions or like giving over to these thoughts in my mind, that was a game changer.
Let me just speak to the men for a second, because just like women have a responsibility to be their brother's keeper when it comes to sort of encouraging them away from lustful thoughts, men have a responsibility to be their sister's keeper when it comes to emotional prudence and emotional intimacy. And so what does that mean? Well, that means that like all of us have a desire to be seen and known and heard, but women especially have a deep, deep need. And so sometimes, you know, you might feel like, oh no, we're like, we're not in a relationship. Like we're just friends. Mm-hmm. We're not going on dates. We're not kissing. Like we're not doing anything. Mm-hmm. But you need to be aware that like, if y'all share a deep emotional intimacy, well, that can be forming bonds and attachments that are not healthy. And you have a responsibility, to guard her heart and your heart. And so what does that mean? Well, that means that like, keeping a friendship as a friendship and keep it looking like a friendship, you know, you shouldn't, if you're not dating, it shouldn't look like you're dating, you know, you shouldn't always be talking, you shouldn't always be texting, you shouldn't be showing up to everything together, not for the looks of anything, but just because like it allows it allows the brain, masculine or feminine, like whatever one, it allows the brain to think that they have a claim that they don't. I mean, this is what leads to long-term damage. So you need, just like you need to not lie with your words, you need to not lie with your actions. And if you're not dating, then it shouldn't look like you're dating.
Right.
And then I think men don't understand this because they are more generally physical. And so they're like, no, like we're not physically doing anything. So like, why would anyone think we're dating?
So we're not dating. Right. But for us, it's more emotional, right? So like if we feel like a guy is being emotionally intimate with us and he's sharing a lot of details of his life and we're having these one-on-one conversations, to us, that feels like we're dating even if we're not doing anything physical a lot of times, right? So again, this can go both ways. Like it can be for guys who are more emotional or girls who are more physical, but in generally speaking, it's usually kind of in those categories. Right. And so just either one, right? Both, for both people, to just be aware of like how you're speaking to a person and how you're acting towards a person.
For sure. Yeah, so. To guard your own heart, and also right. because you have a responsibility to guard your brothers and sisters' hearts.
Yeah, and just be clear with each other, right? Like, this, I think, is something that happens all the time. You know, they mentioned the, like, define the relationship, like the DTR, right? Like, mm-hmm. have a talk up front. Like, if I'm interested in this person, like, guys, if you're interested in a girl, ask her on a date. Like, you don't have to, like, spend all this time thinking about it, right? Like, and in fact, if you ask her on a date, you're going to get your answer quicker, mm-hmm. right? And then if she's interested, then awesome. And if she's not, you can move on with your life and you can find somebody else, right?
Yeah,
and so it can be really kind of a breath of fresh air.
Yeah.
I know for me, even if a guy asks me out who I'm not really interested in and I'm not really attracted to, if he's like, hey, I think you're really cool and I'd like to take you on a date, I feel so great because I realize that I'm seen and known and heard, right? Even if I don't really like the guy in that way, right? And so I know that I've turned some guys down before who have asked me, but like I walked away from that day like feeling good about myself, right?
Sure.
And so just like the clarity is so nice and unfortunately very rare in our culture today. And so just be clear, like be clear about your intentions.
Right. So moving on into the third video with Annie talking, sort of wrapping up the whole series on like how to be a disciple. And, you know, his five tips are to know yourself, to know God, to receive his love. I guess, sorry, his three tips. But let's start with know yourself. Knowing yourself is not this sort of magical thing that happens where one day you're just struck by lightning bolt and now you understand your tendencies and your fears and your desires. It takes work. It takes intellectual work. And so that can happen in a lot of ways, but know that like it somehow, some way you have to trigger or cultivate a lifestyle of examination. Mm-hmm. You have to look at seasons of your life and be like, what was going on in that season? What was I doing? What was I wanted? Why did I do this instead of this?
Mm-hmm.
And that season could be a month, a week, a relationship, a day, whatever it is.
Mm-hmm.
But you need to cultivate a sort of habit of self-examination, or else you're never going to know yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a reason that Annie put that first.
Mm-hmm.
It's because we were made in the image and likeness of God. So if we don't know ourselves, then we're going to be confused as to who God is. We're going to have a twisted, warped version of who God is. For myself, I want to share, I am not a naturally reflective person. So for me, it was journaling. Like, I found that if I didn't journal, then I never sort of slipped into reflection. And so it was in my sophomore, junior year of college when I started journaling a lot. And that sort of helped me understand going back, like, it helped me understand why I struggled with what I struggled with in high school. It helped me understand why friendships fell apart and why some stayed together. And that was me. I know Grace had her own sort of experience with self examination.
Yeah, so different people are different. I mean, I'm a more of a naturally reflective person. So like I constantly am thinking about different situations that I've been in and different relationships that I've been in and different friendships and like, you know, like you were saying, how they fall apart or how they stay together, like why, like asking those questions, you know, and I'm constantly examining my life. But for me, journaling was also great because what it did was a lot of times the feelings and the emotions and the thoughts that I had about these situations were kind of swirling around in my head in such a way that it was very confusing and it felt like spaghetti in my mind. And I was like, I don't know how to separate things or learn anything from this. And so writing it down helped it kind of like get out of the cloud of my brain and like onto paper where I could see it and read it. And like, I was able to kind of process things that way.
Right.
Sometimes it's writing it down for me, like journaling. Other times it's just talking it out with somebody. I'm more of an external processor. And so like I will talk with a close friend, right? That close friend that you're more intimate with than the other ones, right?
Right.
And like hash things out and go through things and talk about your life and say like, what can I learn from this situation? Like, where is God trying to teach me something about who I am and about who he is, you know, like in this situation? And that that kind of processing either on paper or even just like, some of you might be really good at just thinking about things in your mind. You're more of an internal processor, just you and God, right?
Yeah.
Like just you, God, in the adoration chapel, and you're just sitting there and you're talking to God and you're just like thinking about your life, you know, like that can be really awesome as
yeah.
well.
whatever you have to do to examine your life. Socrates said 2,000 years ago, the unexamined life is not worth living. Mm-hmm. And the church fathers thought that Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle were kind of the closest you could get to figuring it out mm-hmm. without Christ. So we really should treat those words
seriously.
Worth their weight. And so the unexamined life is not worth living. But now, moving on from knowing yourself.
Mm-hmm. Know God.
Know God.
Right? So how do you know God? Well, we can learn a lot about him, right? We can learn about him in religion class. We can learn about him at church. We can read the Bible. You know, there's lots of different ways to know about God. But knowing about God is different than knowing God, mm-hmm. right? And before, in this year, we talked about the Holy Spirit and, like, the gifts of the Holy Spirit we receive at baptism and confirmation. And one of them is knowledge. It's not book knowledge. It's not academic knowledge, right? It's intimate relationship knowledge. Like, if I know a person, right? Like, if I know my best friend, it's not that I just know about my best friend. Like, I know my best friend. Like, we have this intimate connection. And I can see beyond what's just on the surface. And that's what we need to have with God, right? Mother Teresa wrote this letter to her sisters. I think I may have mentioned this before. It's very famous. And so these are people who have literally given up their lives to be nuns, right? Like, for God. And yet she wrote this letter to her sisters, and she said, I fear that some of you still do not know God. Like,
whoa.
Right. But like,
that's
crazy. Yeah. Like, but what she meant by that was, like, a lot of you know about God and you even want to serve God. And those things are beautiful and wonderful. But, like, have you seen the way that he looks at you? Right? Like, with mm-hmm. love. Like, have you seen the way that he loves you? Do you know, like, what it is to be in his presence, like, as in the presence of a friend or as in even the presence, in their case, of a spouse? Right.
Right.
And so that's what we mean by know God, right? Like, do you really have a relationship with him?
Right. And this actually ties in or leads directly into the third point, which is receive. Because we can't know God except through the gift of God. You know, so Christ is the word, the final and ultimate revelation. And it's through him that we know God. And that was a pure gift. And just like it was a pure gift 2,000 years ago, the Holy Spirit is pure gift today. Okay, I'm talking a lot of technical jargon. What do I mean? What I mean to say is that until we open our arms wide and hold them up and open our hearts and say, God, who are you? Reveal yourself to me. Show yourself to me. Lord, I want to know you and I just don't. I've got a lot of technical jargon. I just don't know you in my heart. Until we do that and open ourselves to receive, then we never will. Mm-hmm. One of the mentor figures in my life, he says that the way that he came to know God was there was a really confident preacher one day, and the preacher told him, he said, maybe you don't believe in God, that's okay, just ask him to mess with you. Ask him to mess with you. And if you do honestly ask him to mess with you and he doesn't, well, okay, then there you go, God doesn't exist. But if he does mess with you, then
you should maybe seek that out.
Yeah. And I was just blown away by that because I was like, oh my gosh, like, that's faith. Like, that is faith for the preacher to risk everything on God coming through. Mm-hmm. You know, the preacher said, look, ask God to mess with you. If he doesn't mess with you, then fine. He doesn't exist. Whatever.
Yeah. I think part of it is if we ask God to mess with us, like, we're opening ourselves to the possibility that he will speak to us. And so we're more attentive to the ways in which he might show up. Right. Mm-hmm. And so there has to be this idea of receiving. There has to be this openness. Like, that there's not an expectation, but there's an openness, right?
Sure.
So we're more alert, right? We're listening closer to what people are saying, right? We're watching what's happening in our lives. We're examining more what's happening in our lives, and we're able to see God working. And it's not as if God has never been messing with us before,
right?
But we haven't had eyes to see it, right? Mm-hmm. And so if we have these eyes to see it, right, and ears to hear it, then, like, it's amazing what we'll start to notice about God trying to speak to us in our lives. So.
Yeah. And just one more thing is God speaks the language of trust. Mm. So Annie talked about the turning of the wrist from, you know, a palm out receiving to a hand out grasping.
Mm.
And so if you're looking to know God, remember, he doesn't speak a language of demands. He speaks a language of trust.
Mm.
So think of the story of the prodigal son. You know, you have the one son who reaches his hand out grasping and he says, give it to me. And you have the other son who doesn't reach his hand out at all. which shows just as much a lack of trust. You say, no, I'm not going to ask because I know you're not going to give it to
me. You know? And in fact, the older son tries, and we've talked about this in my class before, but the older son tries to earn the gift. Mm-hmm. He tries to say, like, I will work for you, right? Like, he's like, Father, I've been working for you, and you've never even given me so much as a goat to slaughter and celebrate with my friends, right? But he never asked. Yeah, and he was trying to earn it, right? But, like, we don't earn God's grace. Like, he wants to give it to us freely, but we have to have open hands to receive it, right? We have to say, like, God, like, it's not what I want. Like, you know the deepest desires of my heart. You know what I need. Like, please give me whatever it is that you desire to give me, right? And just, like, wait there with your hands out. You know, like, not maybe literally, but, like, this is why, by the way, maybe you've been to a church service before and you've seen people like this. Like, God, or like this, or like, why? Well, it's a physical manifestation of somebody saying, I am open to receive whatever you have to give me, God. So it's like, you don't have to do that in your prayer, but like for some people, doing the physical thing really helps to kind of manifest like what they're trying to say to God, like internally. So maybe that's why you've seen that.
Absolutely. And I mean, just side note, but yeah, the physical, your body and soul, so your body definitely affects your prayer. If I try to if I try to pray lying down, I don't pray, I fall asleep. If I try to pray kneeling, I don't fall asleep, I pray. So your body affects your prayer. It just, that's a
different
fact.
Different people are different too. Like
sure. Yeah, you're not necessarily me. But yeah, I just want to leave you on everything, the theology of the body, this you program, with this one painting. And it's a very simple, very modern religious painting, but it strikes my heart every time. And it's of Jesus bending over, talking to a little girl. And the little girl is holding a teddy bear. And it's quite small teddy bear.
I know what you're talking about.
And Jesus says, please give it to me. And the little girl is crying. And she says, but I love it. I love it. I don't want to. And what the little girl can't see is that behind Jesus' back is this massive teddy bear that's like three times bigger. But the little girl can't have it because she's holding on to this tiny itty-bitty teddy bear. So I want you I'm done explaining theology of the body to you. I'm done talking to you about what love is or how you should live your life. Obviously, I'm not. Keep asking questions. I'm going to be here to mention you. But everything that we've gone over in these previous 10 weeks can be explained just by meditating on that image. Mm. So I'm going to do my best to find the painting and show it to my Moodle class.
Yeah, I'll try to find it too.
Yeah, I'll throw it up on Moodle. But you're holding on to something, and you're saying, I love it. I love it, Jesus. I can't give it to you. But what Jesus has behind his back is so much better.
Mm-hmm.
And that is theology of the body. That is your idea of love, your idea of romance, your idea of everything. Mm-hmm. I'm happy to leave it there. Grace, do you have a final message for
me? Yeah, no, I mean, for me, it's just to plug gratitude, right? That, like, God is a good father. He's a giver of good gifts, right? And there's a whole parable in the Gospels where Jesus says, like, what type of father, like, when you ask for an egg, would give you a scorpion, right? Like, because a good father will give you what you need, right? And if our fathers know how to give good gifts, like, and maybe our fathers don't, right? But some of our fathers do know how to give good gifts. The perfect heavenly father absolutely knows how to give good gifts, right? Mm-hmm. And wants to give good gifts and only gives good gifts. And so to just be grateful and be open to receive that. Like, look at the things in your lives that you have and realize that you didn't earn them. Yeah. Right? That you were given opportunities maybe that other people weren't given. You were given circumstances that other people weren't given. And to just recognize how much God has already given you, and then meditate on the fact that, like, if God has already given me so much, then, like, imagine, like, what is the more, right, that he has to give me. And I don't know, right? Like, I don't know. That's the part of the adventure is that, like, I don't know what God has to give me. But what's really great is that I know that it's going to be good.
Right? Be real good.
Because, like, only good gifts can come from God. So that's all I got.
Awesome.
I do just want to say, too, that you guys have access to the Ascension Press videos for the rest of the summer. I think your subscription doesn't expire. So if there was anything that particularly struck you or anything that you think had some really good things to say, like, to your life, feel free to go back and watch those videos again, okay? So all you have to do is just log into your account like you have been and go back and watch them, you know? Again, I'll be putting, at least in my students' OneNote, the list of, like, dating tips that they went through pretty quick in that video. Yeah, and so if there's any more questions that you guys have or just, like, further things that weren't really talked about that you think should have been talked about, reach out to us. Let us know. And, yeah.
Awesome. Yeah. We'll be praying for you all summer, and we look forward to seeing you coming as soon as possible.
All right. Bye.
God bless.